There are some class of examples like this one, and in these examples what we should do is, it is not just enough that we add the, you know, we add closure once. I'll show you, you'll understand this. See, now I want to find out closure of this. So what is closure of this? Always we have to add whatever is there into the closure, which means dot a comma dollar. Now since there is a dot to the beginning of a, you have to add all the a productions. So I am adding all the a productions. A derives dot ab, or a derives dot. Dot epsilon is nothing but dot. Now why did I add these productions? Because of this a. So what is following that a? Dollar. What is first of dollar? Dollar and dollar. That is why I got look ahead as dollar. Now there, you know, should I stop it here or should I add even more? That is the main difference. You might think that we could stop it here because since there is a dot to the beginning of a, we have added all the a productions. Yes, this is true, you could stop it here, but that is in the case of LR0 items. Coming to LR1 items, you might have to add a one more time. The reason is look aheads might change. So since there is a dot to the beginning of a, I'm going to add a productions again one more time with dot in the beginning, a b or dot. Now why did I add this second set of a productions? Because of dot here, because of this a. Now what is following that a? B dollar. Therefore find first of b. What is first of b? A comma b. What is first of b? A comma b, right? Now if you see this, we have added a productions two times. The reason is we are getting different look aheads. Therefore you could even write it like this. Instead of adding it two times, you could even write it like this: s derives dot a comma dollar, and merging these two you can write a derives dot ab dot, and here the look aheads are dollar and ab, dollar ab, and here the look aheads are again dollar ab. All right, so this is same. So you know, based on this example, I'll show you one more grammar where we might have to add the productions more than one time. So instead of adding the productions more than one time, I'll just add the look aheads. Okay, so let's see the next example. Yeah, let's see this grammar. Like in previous example, construction of LR1 items, canonical collection of LR1 items, is not very straightforward. The reason is we might have to add same productions again and again because there will be changes in look ahead. With this example, I'll explain you. See this. Now e dash derives dot e comma dollar. This is the augmented production, and because of this e, I have to add all e productions. So I'm adding e productions. E derives dot e plus t or dot t. Okay, now why did I add these e productions? Because of this e, right? So after this e, what is remaining? Dollar. You had to find first of dollar. What is first of dollar? I get dollar and dollar. And again, because of this e, if I add e productions again, then because of you know, this plus t dollar, I have to get find first of plus t dollar, then I'm going to get look ahead as plus. See this. Because of this e, I am adding again e production. So what do I get? E derives plus or dot t. Now why did I add this again? Because of this e. Now what is following that? Plus t e dash. Therefore we have to even add plus again, which means I have to add look ahead as plus and plus. Got it? Now because of if you look at these two productions, they are having same LR0 items, but they are having different look aheads. Therefore instead of having these two, I can strike it off, and then I can write plus here and plus here. Okay, so it doesn't make any difference, which means you can remove this and then have the same LR0 items and add the look aheads here itself. Okay, dollar and plus. Now because of this dot before t, I have to add all t productions. So I'm adding t productions. T derives dot t star f or dot f. What will be look ahead is, I have added it because of this t. So whatever is following that, what is following that? Dollar and plus. So here the look ahead will be dollar and plus, dollar and plus, right? And now, because of this T, I have to again add all T productions, right? Therefore, I am going to add again T productions, T derives dot T star F or dot F. Now, why did I add these T productions? Because of this T. What is following the T star? Star F dollar plus. So, what is first of it? Star, which means I get again star and star. So, if you see this, these two are same. In terms of LR0 items, only in terms of look ahead they changed. Therefore, it is as good as writing here as star, star. You need not have this copy and you need not have this copy because you know we are adding the look ahead to the LR0 items themselves. Now, because of this dot before F, I have to add all F productions, F derives dot I. Now, why do I add these F productions? Because of this dot, this one. Now, what is following it? Dollar plus and star. Therefore, look aheads for this will be dollar plus and star. Got it? So, this is I naught. So, one thing you have to observe is we are not going to have these two. Instead of these two, I have added look aheads already there. Now, what about this one? The transition of this on capital E. On capital E, this dot is going to be moved wherever there is capital E before the after the dot, which means E dash derives E dot comma dollar. And what about this? E derives E dot plus T comma dollar or plus. I just moved dot to the right of E. Okay. And now what about T? On T we get E derives T dot this one, and because of this T, T derives T dot star F, right? So what will be look ahead here? Here the look ahead will be dollar and plus, and here the look ahead will be dollar plus and star, right? So one thing you have to observe is this is a final item and this is a shift move, but then this final item will be placed under dollar and plus, and this shift move will be placed under star. Therefore, there is no problem. So even though it might look like a SR conflict, it is not. The reason is this final item is the reduced move corresponding to this final item will be placed under dollar and plus, and this shift will be placed under star. So there is no conflict. Okay, and on capital F, I get a final item, T derives F dot dollar plus and star, and on I, F derives I dot dollar plus star, which means this final item will be placed under dollar plus and star. Okay, now let's finish this. If I go on plus it is going to give E derives E plus dot T comma dollar and plus. The reason is when I applying the transition, look ahead doesn't change, right? And now because of this T, I have to add all T productions. What are all T productions? T derives dot T star F or dot F. Now why did I add this one? I added this production because of this one. So what is following it? Dollar and plus. Therefore, dollar and plus will be look ahead for these two. And now again because of this dot, I have to again add T productions. If I add T productions, then what will be look ahead for them? Look aheads will be this one, right? So I'll be getting star star because of this production. Now I have to add all F productions. If I add F productions, what do I get? F derives dot I, and what will be look ahead? I added it because of this F. What are the look aheads? Dollar plus and star. Okay, and now this one on T, on capital T it is going to be e plus t dot, e derives e plus t dot, comma dollar r plus, this is the final item, and again t derives t dot star f comma dollar plus n star. Okay, so you can fill it up. So it is looking like as if there is a conflict. It is looking like a reduce move and it is looking like a shift move, but then this reduce move is placed under dollar and plus and this shift move is under star, therefore there will be no problem, no conflict. Okay, and you can fill it up. So only one thing that I want you to observe is whenever I am adding a production, again if I have to add one more time the same production, then you need not add it two times, you can just add the look aheads there. So that is one thing you have to keep in mind. Okay, we shall see more examples. We have already seen lots of parsers, all the types of parsers, LL1, LR0, SLR1, LALR1 and CLR1. Now let's see which one is powerful among all this. So if you can look at this diagram, I want to explain the power of all the parsers using this diagram. Okay, now grammars are of two types, unambiguous grammars and ambiguous grammars. So first thing is, if a grammar is ambiguous, no parser could ever parse it, not even the most powerful parser, which is CLR1 parser, right? So only one type of parser can parse even some of the ambiguous grammars, and that parser is operator precedence parser. Therefore, operator precedence parser can parse some ambiguous as well as unambiguous grammars. Now, in coming to this unambiguous grammars, we have various types of parsers which can parse some of the unambiguous grammars. Now the least powerful parser is LL1 and LR0. Now if a grammar is LR0, it will definitely be SLR1. What is the main difference between LR0 and SLR1? In LR0, the reduce moves will be placed in the entire row. And what about SLR1? The reduce moves will be placed only in the follow of left hand side, which means we are reducing the number of reduce moves. Therefore, we are reducing the number of conflicts. Therefore, SLR1 must be really powerful. And now what about LALR1 and CLR1? So in coming to CLR1 and LALR1, we are not placing the reduce moves in the complete row or in the follow of left hand side. We will be placing the reduce move only in the look aheads. Therefore, we are still reducing the reduce moves and the possibilities of conflicts. So if you look at this, the table size might increase in CLR1 as well as reduce moves might reduce. And LALR1 and SLR1, the table sizes are same. So this is the order of power. If a grammar is LR0, it is SLR1, LALR1 and CLR1. If a grammar is SLR1, it is LALR1 as well as CLR1. If a grammar is LALR1, it is definitely CLR1. Now, one thing you should observe is LL1 is not included completely in LR0, or it is not included completely in SLR1, but then it is completely included in LALR1. So from this you must understand that every LL1 grammar is LALR1 grammar. The reason is it is completely included in LALR1, right? So if you take a grammar, if you find out that it is LL1, definitely that grammar will be LALR1. So questions on this in the relationship will be, one thing is what are the relationship among the table sizes, and second thing is what about shift moves, reduce moves and error entries. And given a grammar, they'll ask you what type of grammar it is. Is it LL1 or LR0, SLR1? Okay. And some theoretical questions is, they'll say let a grammar is LR0, then what are the following statements are true? It is definitely SLR1, it is definitely LALR1, it is definitely CLR1. So some questions will be like this. Or if a grammar is LL1, then which of the following is true? It is definitely LR0, it is definitely SLR1, it is definitely LALR1. What is the answer? It is definitely LALR1. If a grammar is LL1, it is definitely LALR1, because it is completely included. Okay, we shall see some of the questions which are asked in previous examinations, and we shall discuss about this. Consider a question, this one. They are asking about SLR1 and LALR1 table for a grammar. So for a given grammar, we know that SLR1 and LALR1 tables will have the same number of states. Only in case of CLR1 table, the number of states could be more. but in terms of SLR1 and LLR1, the number of states will be same. Now they are asking whether go to of both the tables may be different. So actually, if you consider that canonical collection of LR0 items or canonical collection of LR1 items, now in case of LALR1, even though we are looking at LR1 items, we are combining two LR0 items which are different only in look aheads, which means in case of SLR1 and LALR1, the number of states and the number of transitions will be exactly identical. Therefore, go to moves will not be different, they will be same. So this is false. Go to moves are definitely going to be same in both the tables. You can take an example and you can check it. Next one is shift entries are identical in both the tables. Yes, shift entries are definitely identical in both the tables. And next one is reduce entries in the table may be different. Yes, reduce entries are obviously different. In SLR1, where are you going to place reduce entries? In the follow up left hand side. And what about LALR1? We are going to place the reduce entries in the look aheads. Therefore, unless the follow up left hand side and the look aheads both are same, the reduce will be placed in a different entries. Therefore, they may be different. In case if both are equal, if the follow up left hand side and the look aheads both are equal, in that case we get the same table, same reduce entries. Otherwise, we don't get the same reduce entries. So reduce entries in both the tables may be different. And next one is error entries in the tables may be different. Yes, the reason why error entries in the tables will be different is whenever the reduce entries are changing, see, shift is same, go to is same, but only reduce entries is changing, which means if there is a change in reduce entries, then there will be change in blank entries. And what is a blank entry? Blank entry is definitely reduce entry, error entry. Therefore, error entries in the tables are definitely going to be changing. And one more question they might ask you is, one is, let us say N1 is the number of states in SLR1 table for a given grammar, okay? And N2 is number of states in LALR1 table, and N3 is number of states in CLR1 table. Now they didn't give you any grammar. They are saying that these are the number of states for some grammar. What can you say about the relationship among N1, N2 and N3? Whatever the grammar is, always number of states in SLR1 and LALR1 are same. The reason is, even if the lookaheads are different, we are merging the states. Therefore, we get same number of states in SLR1 and LALR1. So, N1 is definitely equal to N2, right? And for some grammars, there is a chance that we might get more states because of some states having more different look aheads, which means some states will be having the same LR0 items, but the look aheads will be different. Therefore, some states will be having some grammars will be having more number of states in CLR1, or they might be equal also. So less than or equal to N3. Whether it is less than or it is equal to, that depends on a grammar. Given a grammar, we can resolve this issue. So in general, this is the relationship, which means in general, the number of states in CLR1 could be either greater or equal to number of states in SLR1 and LALR1. But if you have to find out whether it is actually greater than or equal to, then we should take a grammar and we should see it. So if the grammar contains more than one state which is having same LR0 items but different look aheads, then we can say that the number of states in CLR1 is greater than number of states in LLR1 and SLR1. We shall see some examples where we can resolve this. So in this grammar, they are asking whether this grammar is LL1 or these are the options given. So what is this grammar? Now if you look at this grammar, we have already seen this grammar as a running example with a different name, isn't it? So this grammar is nothing but S derives AA, A derives small a capital A or small b. The same grammar they have asked, right? So actually this grammar is everything, which means this grammar is LL1, LR0, SLR1 and LALR1. So this grammar is definitely LL1. This is SLR1 as well as LL1. This is LALR1 as well as CLR1. So that is why the first option is right. If you have any doubt, you can see this. Where are you going to place this production? This production is going to be placed in the S row. And in the first of CC, which means under C and D. since there is only one production, there is no chance that we get one more production in LL1 parsing table. And where are you going to place this second production? This production is going to be placed under C row and under the column of small c. And this one is going to be placed under C row and under the column of small d. Therefore, this grammar is definitely LL1. Now let's see. We want to find out the number of conflicts in SR, the number of SR conflicts and RR conflicts in this grammar. In the DFA with LR0 items. DFA with LR0 items is nothing but canonical collection of LR0 items. Okay, now they are not actually asking whether this grammar is LR0 or not, SLR1 or not. They are asking what is the number of conflicts. Therefore, you have to construct the complete canonical collection of LR0 items, and in every state you have to examine whether there is SR conflict or RR conflict. Let's see. The starting point is s dash derives dot s, and this is LR0 item, therefore you need not write any look ahead. And because of this s, I am going to add all the s productions. What are all the s productions? S derives dot ss or dot a or dot. That's it. Because of this dot, even if you add one more time s, you get the same thing, because these are just LR0 items. Okay, and now this dot is because dot epsilon or epsilon dot is simply a dot. Now if you look at this production, it is nothing but a reduce move and this is nothing but a shift move. So therefore there is SR conflict. In this state there is one SR conflict. There is reduce move and there is shift move. Let us see what happens on capital S. On capital S, S derives, S dash derives S dot, and let's write dollar here, so that you will not get confused between reduce move and then accepting move. And what about this? S derives S dot S. Because of this S, I have to add all S productions. What are they? S derives dot SS or dot A or dot. Again, in this state, there is a final item, therefore reduce move, and there is a shift item. Therefore, this is also shift reduce conflict. One shift reduce conflict we got. Now, let's see what happens on S one more time. It is nothing but S derives SS dot. And again, see, because of this one, I am getting S derives SS dot. And again, because of this, S derives S dot S or small a or dot. Now see this, because of this final item we got reduce move, and because of this there is a shift move. So there is shift reduce conflict, and moreover there is a final item here also. So between these two there is reduce conflict, and between these two there is shift reduce conflict. So here there is one shift reduce and one reduce conflict is also there, right? Now what about on small a? This one on small a is going to give S derives small a dot, and this one on small a is also going to give the same, and this one on small a is also going to give the same. So this is the canonical collection of LR0 items or DFA with LR0 items, and we found out that in this state I got one SR conflict, and in this state I got one SR conflict, and in this state I got one SR conflict as well as one RR conflict. Therefore, in total we have 3 SR conflicts and 1 RR conflict in 3 states. Okay, so that is the answer for it. You shall see more. Yeah, look at this grammar. They have given this grammar E derives E plus N, E star N, and then N. And they have given a string N plus N into N. Now the question is, for this string, for the given grammar, what are the handles in the right sequential form of reduction? Right sequential form of reduction is nothing but bottom up parsing, and handle is nothing but whenever we find a part in the string, what is that part we are going to reduce to the left hand side. For this example, see this, if I have n plus n star n, now I'll be reducing the first n to e, isn't it? Therefore this n is called a handle. Why? Because it is reduced to e. And now what is remaining is e plus n into n. Then I'll be reducing this e plus n into e. Now what is the handle is e plus n. Now what is remaining is e star n. Next, I'll be reducing E star n to E. Therefore, what is the handle is E star n. See, maybe you know you can understand it in the other way. E derives, I'm just writing the derivation. E derives E star n, and then E derives E in place of first E, E plus E star n, and then this derives C derives n, n plus n into n, right? So if you look at this, what are the handles is you go in the reverse order, and you can find out. So initially n has been reduced to E, therefore n is a handle, and then E plus n has been reduced to E, therefore E plus n is a handle, and then E star n is reduced to E, therefore E star n is a handle. So we have three handles. One handle is n, other handle is E plus n, other handle is E star n. Therefore D is the option. Okay. Now in this question, a grammar is given, and now the question they are asking is whether the grammar is, you know, what is the relationship between the number of states in SLR1, CLR1, LALR1 for the given grammar, which means they are saying that in case if number of states in SL, I just condensed the question, I simplified it so that it will be easier for me to write and for you to understand it. So the question what they are asking is, they are given a grammar and they are saying that if I construct SLR1 parsing table, then the number of states will be N1. If I construct CLR1 parsing table is also nothing but CLR1. CLR1 is also sometimes called as LR1. Okay, now they are saying that for this grammar, CLR1 contains N2 states and LALR1 contains N3 states. Then they are asking you what is the relationship between N1, N2 and N3. So one thing you know, that N1 is definitely equal to N3. This one is for sure. Why? Number of states in SLR1 and LLR1 both are same. And then second thing we know, that this N2 can be greater than or equal to both of them, isn't it? Which means for some grammars, number of states in CLR1 can be larger, and for some grammars, number of states in CLR1 can be smaller. So that one we have to find out. First thing is, for sure N1 is equal to N2, and the second thing is, we are not sure whether there is a difference in the number of states here. So in order to just resolve that issue, we have to construct the canonical collection of LR1 items, and in case if you get two states with same LR0 items and different look aheads, then we can say that number of states are larger. So you need not finish the entire canonical collection of LR1 items. You have to start with canonical collection of LR1 items. Why? Because I want to see the size of CLR1 and compare it with SLR1 and LALR1. Definitely I need canonical collection of LR1 items, and then I should know where to stop it. I am going to stop the solution if I get at least two states which are same in look aheads, which are same in LR0 items but different in look aheads. Because of those two states only, we might get extra number of states. If we don't find any such states, we can say that the states are same in CLR1 and LLR1. Now let me construct canonical collection of LR1 items. So first one is S dash derives dot S comma dollar. This is the augmented production, and because of this S, I am going to add all S productions. S derives dot and dot A. And why did I add this S? Because of this dot before S. What is following that? Dollar. What is first of dollar? Dollar and dollar. This is the first one. And now on small s, on open brace. On open brace, it is going to be S derives open brace dot S close brace comma dollar. So because of this dot before S, I have to add all S productions, right? What are all S productions? S derives open brace S. And why did I add this second S? Because of this S. What is remaining after that? Close brace and dollar. Therefore, what is first of close brace and dollar? It is simply close brace, right? And then S derives dot A, and this is also added because of this production, therefore look ahead is going to be close brace. Now if I get two states which have same LR0 items but different look aheads, I can stop and say that number of states in CLR1 are greater. Why? Because we could merge these two states later to find LALR1. Okay, now on small a, we are going to get s derives small a dot comma dollar. And here also on small a, we are going to get one more state, s derives small a dot comma close brace. Now if you observe these two states, both these states are having same LR0 item, same LR0 item, but a different look ahead, which means coming to the CLR1 table, both the parsers are different. Coming to the CLR1 table, these are two different states, therefore number of states are more, and when we go for the construction of LALR1, we actually merge these two, therefore number of states will reduce. So the actual relationship is, for this grammar, for this example, N1 is equal to N3. It is always true for any grammar, but for this example, they are less than N2. The reason is number of states in CLR1 is more. There are more states, right? So what is the option? The option is B. Okay. So we have seen that many of the parsers cannot work for ambiguous grammars, right? But then there are some advantages if you go for ambiguous grammars. The advantages are, one thing is, ambiguous grammars are simpler to see. I'll just give you an example and show you what is the difference between ambiguous grammar and unambiguous grammar. We already know what is an ambiguous grammar. So if for any string, if I get more than one parse tree, then the grammar is ambiguous. Let us say this is the grammar, e derives e plus e, e star e or id. This is a grammar, and we have seen that this is an ambiguous grammar. The reason is, for any string we are getting, for some string we are getting more than one parse tree, and we have seen that the unambiguous version of the same grammar which generate the same language but with the unambiguous grammar is this one, e derives e plus t, t derives t star f, f derives id. So this is an ambiguous grammar and this is the unambiguous version of the same grammar. Now we have seen that all the parsers will fail to parse this grammar. The reason is, okay, except that operator precedence parser, remaining all parsers fail to parse this grammar. The reason is the grammar is ambiguous. And if you have to use any parser like LR0, SLR1, LALR1, CLR1, we are supposed to use this grammar, right? But then, even though there are some conflicts using ambiguous grammars, sometimes we still go for ambiguous grammars because there are some advantages. One advantage is, if you look at the number of productions are less here, which means the grammar is shorter and easier to represent. And second thing is, this is very natural and meaningful. If you see this, expression is nothing but expression plus expression or expression into expression or ID. It is natural to read and it is simple to understand. It is easier to understand. And the third advantage is, see this. Now, coming to this grammar, the associativity and precedence are fixed, which means if you take this grammar, you need not specify the associativity and precedence, or you cannot change the associativity and precedence later. So by looking at this grammar, you can find out that star is having higher precedence than plus, and plus is left associative, therefore, and star is left associative. This is fixed. But coming to this grammar, the rules are not fixed, which means star and plus, our precedence is not fixed, and moreover associativity is also not fixed. Therefore, there is flexibility in this grammar. The reason is, later at some point of time, we can specify what about the associativity and what is about the precedence. We can change the associativity and precedence. And next one is, let us say I have to derive id. Directly e will derive id. But if you take this grammar, e will derive t, and t will derive f, f will derive id. So coming to bottom up parsers, if I have to reduce id to e, I have to reduce it to f, and then f to t, and then t to e. So it is going to take three steps. But here, using this grammar, it is simply one step. So you can understand that from this explanation, you can understand that there are some advantages of using ambiguous grammars. So even though ambiguous grammars are not useful for parsing, there are some advantages if you go for it. Now let us see why this ambiguous grammar is not useful for parsing. One reason is, we get lot of conflicts in the parsing tables. If you go and, if you try to construct LR0 parsing table for this grammar, we end up in states where we get conflicts. Now, if you could resolve those conflicts somehow meaningfully, then yes, we can use this grammar. We can use this grammar in which there will be number of less number of productions, therefore there will be less number of states and the passing table will be smaller. Only thing you have to consider is there will be some conflicts which you have to resolve. For example, you might enter one state where you might get this production like this. The conflicts will be E derives dot here and then E derives E plus E dot along with some other productions, you might get this production. If you go for canonical collection of LR0 items for this grammar, you might end up in this state. So there could be some other productions too, right? But what is the meaning of this is we have reached a state in which I am looking at plus and I have already seen one plus. I am looking at one plus and I have already seen one plus. Where do you get this is ID? If I have the input ID plus ID plus ID, then if you are standing at this point, if you have scanned till this point, it means that you have already seen one plus and you are about to see one plus. You have already seen one plus and you are about to see one plus, right? Now there are two choices. Whether either you could reduce this to E, which means you could perform this one first, or you could shift. Shift means you could, you know, you could reduce this one. If I go for shift, then plus is becoming right associative. If I go for reduce, then plus is becoming left associative. Why? Because if I, you know, if I reduce it here itself, then leftmost plus is getting evaluated first. So if I reduce it here, I'll get this and then get this, which means this one is getting evaluated. If I go for shift, this one is getting evaluated. So if you can resolve this conflict meaningfully and manually, yes, we could use that grammar. For example, in this case, if you want plus to be left associative, if even if there is SR conflict, you have to go for reduce so that you'll get this, right? So one more example is maybe you will get one more state like this. One more state is E derives E dot plus E and then E derives E star E dot. Now see what should be done here. So in this state, when do you get such a state is if the example, if the input is ID plus ID, ID star ID plus ID. And if we have scanned till this point, if we have scanned till this point, which means we have seen E star E and then we are going to see a plus. So whether should you reduce this to E or should you shift it to plus, right? Which means should you go for a reduce move or should you go for a shift move? So in this case, if you want to give more precedence to star, then you should go for reduce move. Therefore, even though there is SR conflict here, in this case, if you go for reduce, this can be resolved successfully. And let us say there could be one more example like this. One more state you might get. And in that state, you might get something like this. E derives. We have seen E plus E. And we are about to see a star. E derives E dot star E. Now when do you get this state is if the example is if the input string is ID plus ID star ID, which means you have seen one ID plus ID and you are about to see a star. What do you want to do? Do you want to reduce this or do you want to go for star and then come back to plus? So there is SR conflict here. So if you go for reduce, we are actually giving higher precedence to plus. If you go for shift, we are giving higher precedence to star. Therefore, in this example, in this state, if you want to resolve it meaningfully, you should go for shift, which is nothing but giving higher precedence to star. So even though some grammars are ambiguous, we could still use them for parsers, bottom up parsers, if you can resolve the conflicts meaningfully. And there is one more parser generator tool. There is a tool called YAC. In Unix, there is a software called YAC, yet another compiler, which is a software which will automatically generate a parser for the given grammar. And this is actually using LALR1 parsing tables. So whatever grammar you give it as input, it is going to produce LALR1 parsing tables as output. And in this case, whenever YAC comes across a grammar which is having conflicts, it might not, you know, it need not be any ambiguous grammar. even for unambiguous grammars also, whenever React comes across any conflicts, if there is a SR conflict, it is going to, you know, go for shift. And if there is RR conflict, it is going to go for first reduce. So SR conflicts are always resolved in favor of shift, and RR conflicts are always resolved in favor of first reduce. What do I mean by first reduce is, if I have R1 and R2, these two are the two productions, first production and second production, then it is going to take the first production itself, automatically it is going to include. So if you give any grammar to ACK as input, if the grammar is containing conflicts in LLR1 parsing table, then the conflicts are automatically resolved by ACK. If there is a SR conflict, it is going to go for shift, and if there is a RR conflict, it is going to go for first reduce. First reduce means, if I have productions R1, R2, R3, so on, it is always going to take R1 as the first, R1 as the main choice, okay?